axis, which is passing from center of the hip joint to the center of the knee joint, and have that cut perpendicular to this line. The proximal tibial cut again is from is perpendicular to the long axis of the tibia. So the center of the knee joint to the center of the ankle, that is our long axis of the tibia, and we are cutting perpendicular. And the third component is intra-articular balancing, and that is basically medial lateral or even posterior anterior balancing. And variations of these in deformity corrections, that is where devil is. The devil is really in the details. You may have complex deformities like this. Principles remain exactly the same. The devil is in the details of what you do in these complex cases. So let's consider the distal femoral cut. You may use navigation or medullary canal as a reference in a conventional surgery. And variation is going to be in presence of any extra-articular deformities that may be because of the fractures or any other reason. Or you may have a fixed flexion deformity or hyperextension. And let's consider what are the variations. For example, you have a case like this. You cannot use intramedullary canal as a reference axis. You have to use navigation, and that is what was used here. And because of the medullary canal distortion, you cannot even have an intramedullary stem for this situation. But the aim is that you achieve the neutral mechanical axis. And that is what was achieved in this case using navigation. So navigation may be required, although some surgeons would prefer to use it for every case. In my hands, I use it when this is necessary. I don't use it for every case. Again, the DFC variations, distal femoral cut variation, will be in presence of an hyperextension deformity like this. We'll see many examples of that later on. And you obviously need to minimize your distal femoral cut in order to get your extension space correct. If you consider tibial cut variations, I mean, most of the cut is going to be perpendicular. You can, have variations on the thickness of the tibial dissection. And second variation is on the slope. Now, slope of the tibial cut depends on the system that you're using. Some systems demand a 0 or 3 degree slope, and some systems demand a 7 degree slope. And you may have slight variation possible in the slope that we use. For example, in hyperextension deformity, you may consider increasing the tibial slope, obviously not too much, because what by increasing the tibial slope, you will be cutting less bone from the anterior tibia, and thereby you'll be tightening your extension space a little bit. Similarly, for fixed flexion deformity, you may consider reducing the slope, so thereby you have more resection from the anterior tibia. So it may be manageable to, it will be possible to maybe get extension space balance right. When you consider intra-articular balance, it's again titrated soft tissue release that we're talking about. Now, the basic principle remains that any elongated or stretched out structure cannot be shortened by any means. So we are relying on, releasing that structures that are actually contracted and short. And for example, here, if you see, as I mentioned earlier, some cases you may need to do a lot of release. Some cases you may not need to do a lot of release. For example, a grotesque looking knee like this, a gross valgus. But if you take a stress X-ray, it's actually a fully correctable deformity. So you can actually get away with using just a PS knee. You do not need to increase the level of constraint. Any soft tissue laxity that you see on an X-ray, for example, here you can see gross varus or gross valgus. You have to really minimize your bony cuts. That is the bottom line. You do not worry about the level of bone defect that is going to be left behind. Bone defects can be dealt with. But if you straight away start taking with 9 or 10 millimeters resection based on the normal area, you are actually going to have trouble with much thicker poly. And so the basic principle is that you try and minimize the bony cuts whenever you see soft tissue laxity like this. The aim is to achieve equal and balanced flexion and extension gaps. Now, it's important to remember that any tibial cut change is going to change both flexion and extension gap. Any distal femoral cut change is going to affect only the extension gap, whereas any posterior femoral condylar cuts is going to change only the flexion gap, and you may actually change the rotation of the femoral component to achieve that. It's important to know what upsizing and downsizing is going to do to your gaps, because if you have an anterior referencing system, any downsizing is going to change only the flexion space. Whereas if you have a posterior referencing system, you do not have much leeway there. So I prefer actually to use an anterior referencing system whereby I am in control. I can actually upsize the femur if I need to, if I need to tighten the flexion space. So anterior referencing system is quite useful in such scenarios. And you, as a surgeon, you have to really know what system you are using, whether it is anterior referencing or posterior referencing. Not every complex knee really requires a hinge. I think that has to be the key message of this webinar. because you may see some grotesque looking deformities. For example, here, if you can see a gross deformity with the massive tibial bone loss, as you can see here. And I'm just going to show you some pictures. This is on exposure of the tibia. And you would, after doing the minimal tibial dissection that was seen here, that is what one is left with. And that is what with the trial tibial base plate on. And there's a defect that is there in the posterior side. So the same tibial base plate that was the tibial plateau resection was used as a bone graft here and fixed with 2 K-wires and then fixed with 2 screws. And that is a postoperative X-ray. So if you consider the preoperative grotesque looking knee, this is easily managed by a posterior stabilized implant here. And that patient went on to do very well. So not every grotesque looking knee really requires a hinge to be put on it, or even a constrained knee for that matter. Here's a case with tibial fracture with non-union with gross osteoarthritis. You would think that, oh, probably I need to use a fully constrained knee. Of course, you have a case like this, you have to keep the constrained knee available to you. But at the end of the day, you may not need it, because this is what was done for this patient. Offset rod tibial base plate was lateralized. A graft was used for the medial defect. And in a matter of 4 months, the fracture goes on to unite. And you get away with a simple posterior stabilized knee. So it's important to appreciate that not every complex knee requires really a hinge or increasing the deformities. You need to really identify the issues. I'm just going to summarize here. You really need to plan, and I think execute the plan. And that is the way for your success. And that is, I think, the conclusion of my presentation. Now, I can stop sharing my screen here. I can invite some comments from, I think we have Sharon joining us here. Yeah. He's going to be talking.
That was a brilliant introduction to the whole webinar today. I don't think we need to talk. I just apply these principles and all the talks are done, really.
So I suppose we can get Sharon to start with his presentation on varus knee. And as we go along, we can have more discussions on this. Is that okay with everybody?
Yeah.
All right, lovely. So Sharon, please crack on with your presentation.
Yeah. Thank you, Hemant. I was just saying you so beautifully summarized the entire principles. Probably there's no need for any other talk. Just apply those principles and all problems will be solved. So balancing a complex varus knee. We all know varus knee is our biggest challenge, and it is something which we do more often than any other deformity. I'm not able to move my slide. Just give me a yeah. So here we go. So if you look at this, this gentleman, he's a doctor himself, a general practitioner. He walks with such amount of gross virus, and once you use all the principles and correct him, he's back to his normal. So As Hemant already said, the mechanical axis is what we want to restore in whichever way you want to do it. And anatomical axis is something which you want to consider while achieving the whole thing. In the pathophysiology of a varus knee, the medial compartment bone and cartilage loss is the issue which leads to many things as you go along: the inflammation, fibrosis, and contracture of the MCL. The osteophytes, which you should never underestimate, contribute hugely to the whole situation. Sometimes, like Hemant showed in some of the cases, the bone defects make it look very gross and make it look as if the soft tissues are responsible. Once you do a stress view, you will be able to correct the entire deformity quite effectively, and that's because the femur is sinking into the defect there. And on the convex side, you can quite easily, you can see, let me see where I am, with time, if somebody has got a varus knee and they walk along with that, you do have this varus thrust gait, which invariably elongates the lateral aspects and gives you the situation. You can classify into mild, moderate, and severe. And operating on a varus knee, you certainly need to know your anatomy well so that you know what releases can give you what correction and how to take it forward. Of course, more importantly, as we have been speaking, the clinical classification, whether it's fully correctable, partially correctable, or is it a fixed varus, becomes a very important aspect. I personally, when I started doing in knees, I used to do too much of a correction. Quite often, it's not required. Once you get on with it, and these days I find myself doing less and less tissue releases and correction, because most of them are correctable once you take care of situations. Soft tissue elements, obviously, are the contracted MCL, deep and superficial. PCL contractures are to be noticed, because quite often varus is associated with a flexion deformity. And if you are trying to do a CR knee, one needs to be sure you balance it well. PCL sacrificing gives you that effective control of balancing much more easily. Tight posterior capsule, again, a part of the contribution for a varus with flexion deformities. Never to forget the bony elements, the osteophytes and defects. Look at this. This is a pretty strange situation. And one of the other soft tissues one needs to be mindful is when there is a subluxation, popliteus could be a factor. Normally, in a varus knee which is subluxed, popliteus could be a factor. That's something which one needs to keep in mind, because we are very reluctant to do anything with popliteus in general. But in extreme situations, this could be a factor. The key steps here for me are removal of osteophytes, and then I do the bony cuts. Quite often, there's no need of doing anything else. And then soft tissue releases if needed. Medial defect reconstruction is something when you're dealing with gross, difficult varus knees. You can see that osteophytes, it's medial osteophytes, all of them, we take it off. But sometimes you will miss out on the posterior osteophyte. One needs to, if you're doing a PS knee, subluxing the tibia in front of the femur becomes very important. And taking away all the posterior for osteophytes gives you that much better and cleaner idea of what needs to be done. Very important way that your arthrotomy, your medial arthrotomy itself starts your soft tissue release. Raising a flap subperiostally cannot be emphasized more. You subperiostally do it so that the sheet of tissues are in continuity and it will never go wrong. And then you release your, depending on the need, gradually in a very controlled manner, you do your MCLs, superficial and deep, and pressants. I can go down as far as 10 to 15 centimeters. As long as you're subperiosteal, you'll not do too much of damage. Extension tightness, if you've got tightness in the extension and the soft tissue release to go to is all in the posterior part, the capsule and the posterior medial corner are important parts to release. And if the flexion tightness is there, it's usually the structures right in the front, right up to the pes, you need to release them. Look at this. This looks like a very gross varus deformity, but you go and remove all the osteophytes and it pretty much corrects itself. You do not have to release too much of soft tissues. For me, I don't jump and do soft tissue release unless it becomes necessary, and you do it in a gradual manner. Pie cresting. This is very popular and I used to do it very frequently. Over the time, I have found that it's pretty uncontrolled. It's gone off my armamentarium. I very rarely do pie cresting. It's not as controlled as I would like it to be. I believe more in soft tissue release and doing something else to get this correction rather than doing pie cresting, even though it's a very popular method and one needs to know how to do this. Let me just take you through a very quick video, and this will... This is something which I would like to share. How do we bridge a soft tissue? How do we correct a defect in the bone? You can see classically in this video, there's a huge medial defect, and you know that when you take away the posterior condyle with your cuts, and that pretty much fits nicely into this. I'm showing this video where you do not use wedges or any metal, but you use the bone to reconstruct the defect. And I've been doing it over a period of time, and I must be having at least about 40 cases where we have effectively done this and have pretty good long-term results. You measure the defect, you know this is deep enough, and this defect is deep and it is wide enough, and just a screw insertion of that kind will not give you that stability, and one needs to do these cuts. If you see, look at the steps carefully. I've covered myself with an osteotome at the back, a curved osteotome, and fashioning this cut where you have a uniform cut across from front to back. Then you make multiple drill holes in that area to create a raw surface, and you keep your your bone in the defect and see how it augurs well. Once you do that, you're pretty much ready to use that bone. You check where exactly your screw hole should go using an angel wing, because that's where the tibial cut surface is. Go below that, put the drill hole, and then put the drill hole and get everything ready. And the next thing I do is take particulate bone graft and use that to punch in into that gap where your bone, where your bigger bone graft is going to sit. This particulate graft takes away all the little crevices and the little unevenness of the bone. And then you put them in and you put your screw with a washer, tighten it nicely, and you do the second hole just to give you enough stability, put the second screw in. And you've done this using an angel wing so that you know that you're not above the place where you're going to cut away the bone. And then you take your saw, you have got the plane of the tibial cut, you take away the bone which is there, and once carefully you do this, and just if you can notice, I've held the two screws with two screwdrivers, because while you're doing this, it can easily loosen up the screws and the whole thing can fall apart. These are little things you learn with experience, and once you stabilize that and then you take away the bone, and you can see how nicely it's reconstructed, and you can now take away the little extra cartilage if it is jutting out. Be carefully doing that slowly, and then you can place your tibial plate and see how well it'll get covered. And this for me has worked consistently. And obviously when you're doing this, if the defect is bigger than 1/3 of the cross section, you need to stem these so that we get that, because that it's hardly possible to see because the particulate graft you put in between the two bigger bone chunks, it practically bridges the whole thing. And this for me has worked well over a period of time. This is classically a guy with a severe bone defect, and you can see how he walks. All of us come across this situation day in and day out. Thin, tall guy with a big bone defect. And what you do exactly what I showed, how to get rid of this bone defect and then stem it. This seems to have worked very well and consistently in my hands. And the cost also is a factor, which is much less. It would take about 10 to 12 minutes additional to finish this aspect of the procedure. This is another situation where there's a stress fracture. Gross varus knees, sometimes you miss out on the stress fracture unless you take full length views. And when you see this situation, that is a contributor to the varus. And of course, like Rajesh showed, Hemant showed one of the x-rays, you use a stem extension, no sweat on this, use a stem extension. As you can see, over 6 months time, it's completely united and these guys do very well. There's no need to do any extra metal work. Yet another extremely difficult situation. You can see practically the insertion of MCL is avulsed out, and this is such a gross deformity. Like Hemant said, you need to keep your armamentarium of all the implants in place, and sometimes when a situation as gross as this is there and you go inside and find it's extremely difficult to balance, then you resort to a hinge, which is of course the last resort when you're not able to balance the ligaments. And this gentleman, I've done the right one and is waiting for the left one, and now probabilities we need a hinge on the other side. In conclusion, I think one overestimates the need of soft tissue release. With experience, you know most of them correct reasonably well. When you cannot correct it, be sure and sequentially correct by doing soft osteophytes to be taken out, then soft tissue releases to be done. And you should have the skill sets to manage the bone defects. And once you can do that as effectively, whichever way, you can use metal wedges or you can use bone graft and then stem it appropriately, you will get the best possible results.
Yeah, wonderful, Sharan. That was a nice exposition of how you deal with a complex varus knee. Participants, I think please ask questions through your chat, and we'll take the questions as we go along. Just one question I can think of, Sharan. You talked about popliteus release.
Yeah.
And at what stage would you consider that popliteus release? I mean, during surgery, say if you had done a distal femoral cut, proximal tibial cut, the knee is still subluxed.
Yes.
And tight.
I think it is not something which you do straight away, because it's extremely difficult to assess if the popliteus is really tight or however the x-ray looks. Even in a sublux knee, it may not have finally resulted in a popliteus contracture, but right after balancing you find it is tight, and it of course you are doing a PS knee, you'll have a post to stop it from subluxing, but you will find tightness in spite of the best balancing. Then you gently go ahead and release the popliteus, you'll find everything falls into place so much better and your rollback is better and everything looks better.
Yeah, I mean, what I usually do is I put my finger on that popliteus after I've done my DFC and tibial cut, and yeah, you can actually many times see that it is actually a very tight taut structure. Yeah, Rajesh, yes, you want to have a comment?
Yeah, I think, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can, yes, hear you.
Yeah. So, Sharan, your technique, you know, yeah, we showed the one of the technique in American Academy 2003. Our techniques are very similar, except that at the point when you put the screws,
yeah,
I put the screws through the superior surface, right, where it will be hidden under the plate, and right, it will give you a little compression, because rest of the technique is just same, except that this part, why don't you consider putting that screw?
Certainly, the logic behind that was, Rajesh, was you want to be perpendicular to the cut surface, and that would give you more perpendicularity. And another thing is, what worries me of putting straight in is you're having a metal tray, and if the metal screw can, two metal surfaces rubbing against each other to that extent, maybe unfounded, but that is one of the considerations why I didn't.
No, I think actually your mechanical strength would be better if you go vertically, and what I showed in that technique in way back 2003 is that we bury the screw,
right
countersink it, and there is a little cement layer between the two metals,
right. I tend to use a washer, and burying becomes a little difficult. It's so cancellous, it just sinks in, doesn't give enough compression, is another concern for doing that. Anyway, I take the point, Rajesh. No, thanks.
So, you know, I've been using that technique from 98 99.
Right.
We wrote a chapter in Nandu Vaidya's book, maybe 200 cases. I've never had a problem. And it gives such a great compression at the fracture site. But yeah, I guess.
Thank you, Sharan.
And I think we move on. As your questions keep coming, I think we'll take them. And Sharan, if you can just keep a track of those questions.
I will. I'll
Next is Dr. Rajesh Maniar. He's going to talk on balancing a complex valgus. Rajesh, all over to you.
Thank you, Hemant. Have you got the screen?
Yeah, we can see that.
Okay, balancing of complex valgus knee. I think the things that we need to really remember is that a lot of things are important. If you look at the femoral mechanical axis and anatomical axis angle, I'm not able to move this. Yeah, now you can see that on the normal side where there is no valgus, it is about 6 degrees, but it is always lesser on the valgus side. So start from doing a correct cut on the femur, because if you make an appropriate cut, you need to balance that much more. Also remember, it is not just mechanical axis, it is the individual femur and tibial alignment that is important. Of course, I use navigation to do that correctly, but you can bear that in mind even if you're using mechanical instruments. What I find is most important, whether it is a minor valgus or a very complex valgus, is three findings on the examination: how correctable it is, what is the status of the medial collateral ligament, and of course, don't forget to examine that lateral popliteal now beforehand, particularly if the deformity is severe and it is uncorrectable, or it also has a flexion deformity. Now, we know what are the structures to release on the lateral side. As the earlier speakers have said, that we do need to release on the tighter side. ACL, PCL, of course, would help you to correct any severe deformity. Other structures that can become tight are IT bend. You can release it on the Gerdes tubercle or transversely. If it is for a severe deformity, it is better to release it at the joint line transversely. But most of the smaller deformities, you can either release at Gerdes tubercle or you can do a bicrusting. Popliteus tendon, we used to release that much easily earlier, in the earlier days. Now, currently, we think that the popliteus probably we don't want to touch unless it is really, really necessary. What we now release first is the posterior lateral capsule, and that is released, at least for me, I release it on the tibial side, starting from the right posterior where the cruciates are attached, starting from there, going over the posterior lateral corner and coming more laterally. If none of this works, then lateral collateral ligament, biceps I don't, and lateral collateral, the way I tackle that, I do an epicondylar osteotomy, but you could, if you want, release it on the fibular attachment side too. Now I'll show you my techniques. The other point is that remember, and Leo Whiteside taught us this, that think what is tight in which position. If flexion and extension both are tight, you have lateral collateral and popliteus that is tight. If it is only the extension, it is the IT bend, retinaculum, biceps. If it is only the flexion, that it is mainly posterior lateral capsule. So these are the standard techniques. I'll go further. What is important is the implant selection. As the case becomes complex, you will have to keep your things, all armamentarium ready with you, standard components, constraint and hinge. But let us see, when do you need what? Now, these are the three different types of medial collateral ligament. First is the valgus, on your left is the valgus with a normal medial collateral ligament functioning. The middle one where it is stretched, and the last one where it is incompetent. So based on this, you decide your implants. In a competent MCL, your standard implants will be good. In a stretched MCL, for most of the time, and as you get more experience, for most of the time, you will be able to put a standard implant, but keep constraint nearby. For an incompetent medial collateral ligament, least you will need is a constraint implant and rarely a hinge. As Hemant pointed out, don't jump into putting a hinge in all the severe gross-looking deformities. Just the examples here. Here is the mid, which is normal-looking, and a standard PS knee. Here is an MCL which is stretched, and still on table you are able to balance so that you don't need a constraint. Here is an incompetent MCL. You can see the stretch is quite significant. And such severe laxity on the lateral side. And I've used a constrained knee. And here is 8 years post-surgery, good alignment and good function for the patient. Now the situation where you have a fixed valgus deformity, which is not correctable. That is where the issues come up and your balancing will have to go one stage further. This patient, overall 25 degree of valgus after I exposed it and put my computer navigation pins, which with all the soft tissue release that I spoke to you about, the cruciate, the posterior lateral capsule, the osteophytes, it has come back and the IT bend directly over the at the joint level. I cut it transversely and it has come to 6 degree of valgus. Now, I don't think this is the amount of valgus that you would like to leave behind, and therefore we need to do something more. And what I select in this patient is to do the lateral epicondylar osteotomy. And once you do the osteotomy, the knee just becomes completely open. You can bring it into as much wear as you want to do. And the key point is for you to know where exactly you want to attach that osteotomy point. And in my case, the navigation helps me where exactly I want to attach it. So you bring it distally and posteriorly as required. If you want to release only the extension, if it is tied only in extension, you just migrate it distally. If it is flexion and extension, both are tight, you migrate it distally and posteriorly, and you titrate it as much as you want. And then you put two screws, and then you get a good correction. As you can see here, I put a constrained knee, patient was significantly osteoporotic, there are stems on either side. Here she is 1 year post-surgery, good function. Osteotomy being cancellous area, heals very quickly. See here that the patella is completely on the lateral side of the femoral condyle. Bone is extremely osteoporotic, so that is one thing to bear in mind. If the patient has not used this knee significantly, you'll have osteoporosis. And as you expose, you need to make sure that you go slow and maybe do your soft tissue releases rather than trying to force any movement. So for this patient, this preoperative. Now, as I open, you can see that the quadriceps, the VMO is right in the front, patellized completely laterally. Standard exposure, and you can see where the patella was articulating, flat surface on the lateral side, and here it is moving laterally. So the standard cuts on the, I did all the exposure, all the cuts using cast, trial reduction, soft tissue corrections, whatever. And then look at it, it is still in about 12.5 degrees of valgus, which certainly needs a further correction. So now the lateral epicondylar osteotomy. And what I do is I put a temporary two wires to try and hold it in place and check. And I pass through the notch because I use PS. I have an excess here in the notch, put two wires and hold the osteotomy temporarily so that at least it gives you some stability, and then put your two screws. And here she's come down to -1 degrees, and which is what my target is. For all the varus, my target is about 1 or 2 degrees of varus, depending on how fat or how tall the patient is. And for valgus, it is 0 to -1. And here it has come back to -1 degree. And this is, you can see that it has been moved more distally than more posteriorly. But you do as exactly how much you need. Now, the only problem was left with this patient was the lateral, the patellar tracking, which was still lateral. It was a dislocated patella. So I do a complete lateral release using my technique, which is outside-in technique, is against the inside-out technique. And I'll show you this technique in a short, this thing. We published it in 2012 in CORR, the technique, and in this year in American Academy, 2020, our video was shown. It's a 10-minute video showing how to do this technique. So we do it in three steps. First step is the middle part. The second is the distal part. And third is the proximal part. Once you do all that release, the patella comes back. The tracking comes back down into the middle. So this severely looking patellar dislocation in a valgus has come back to tracking. I would put this as grade 1A tracking. I have classified the tracking for that release in that paper in CORR. So this is 1A tracking, which is near normal. And then further, we enhance the tracking by doing a double breasting of the VMO. You saw that initially VMO was quite a large and anteriorly. We double breasted that. And this is post-op where the tracking is corrected. Patella is now, you can see right in the front. This is at 2 months. The osteotomy, you can see how much distally it has moved. And this is the lateral view showing patella is now tracking right exactly in the front and in the notch. And this is at 3 months, good function. And the bending to 90, which has further increased to about 100, 110 now. So this is the technique which was published in CORR earlier. And it was shown at the academy this year, with the highest number of views. So it's the three steps. What is most important, that it is done from outside in. That stops hematoma from extravasating and getting subcutaneous, which is where the main issue is. You can see that the synovium is intact. Synovium is left intact, and therefore there is no communication between outside and the joint inside. And that's why I like this technique. It's done in three steps. You can see the patellar marking 1 centimeter lateral to that. Start with the mid patellar level, then release the distal part up to the upper border of the patella, and then the proximal part up to the upper border of patella. This is the step two. This leaves behind the superior lateral genicular artery intact. And if you have to release the step three, which is required in about 30% of the patient, 25 to 30% of the patient, then you have to ligate the superior lateral genicular artery because you cut it. A little bit of the technique where is the patella mark. This is where I begin with a sharp knife. So the technique video this year at AOS has won the Crystal Award as well. The rest of the release I do using CDs. This is the distal part. You can see the angle in his entire company. And here is a superior lateral genicular artery. So I have not removed. I'm just showing you where you would release further if you need to. In this particular patient, only step 2 was required. And the tracking has come back to normal. So in summary, I would like to say that for a complex valgus knee, as has been said earlier, go step by step. There is nothing different you do. You just go step by step and take it till the end, that till you get a correct balancing and correct alignment. Correct alignment is the first step. Then getting a correct balancing is the second step. And I think choose your standard or a constrained implant as required. Most of the cases can be tackled with standard implants. Rarely you need constrained. Hardly ever I have used hinge. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah, thank you very much, Rajesh. That is a very comprehensive way of dealing with valgus deformities. If there are any questions, maybe we can take them now.
I've been keeping track of the questions, Anant. So far, I think there's a discussion about what Rajesh technique of bone grafting in varus defects, whether the screws have to be vertical or transverse. I think we have discussed that. And another interesting question is, when you put a stem extension in case where you made good your bone defects, this stems, should they be diaphyseal loading or dangling because you want to load your bone graft? That's a question. Whether you put just a stem extension which is small and dangling so that the bone graft is loaded, or you're trying to bypass that and take the load directly to further. I think that's an interesting question. Anybody has got views on that?
Yeah, I think if it is a short dangling stem, it will have to be fully cemented. But if you actually use anything longer than that, I prefer to have a well-fitting, canal-fitting stem that is uncemented. So I don't want to put cement all the way down in the canal. Yeah. So that's the way I do it. And I think it works well. Yeah, Rajesh.
I think the idea is it's not all or none. You want to load your bone graft. At the same time, you don't want to overload it. That's why you're putting the stem. And the best scenario in a varus knee like this, you want to put a short stem and cement it. If you put a uncemented, long and completely diaphyseal loading stem, then you might as well not put a bone graft there. And I think, so the idea is that you don't want to have a dangling stem which does nothing. You want to have a stem which is going to give you that stability and take some amount of load off the bone graft.
I think that I would agree with that, a very sensible way of looking at it. But if you, the whole idea of the stem is to prevent the varus or valgus stress too much so that it doesn't again take your graft, put all the pressure on the graft. So the graft has to share the load with the stem taking some of the graft. So I think balancing that, not too big, not too small, sounds perfect. Anybody else has got any opinion? Just another
aspect. You know, Rajesh, in some valgus knees, especially rheumatoid patients, they have the deformity within the diaphysis of the tibia itself, tibia valga. You know, you see that quite frequently, tibia valga with extortion. That is quite frequently seen with these rheumatoid patients. And in those patients, if you try to use a normal length of tibial extension stem, it becomes a problem because of this tibial diaphyseal deformity that starts almost at the metaphyseal level. And these bone sizes
are small.
Yeah, you need to use a very short, tiny stem and maybe fully cement in if you want. We're going to use a stem. What's your take on that?
So I think the extra articular deformities will have to be dealt as they are. If you are able to connect it intra articularly, you go ahead and.
I think, Rajesh, your connection is a little unstable. We are not hearing you. You're frozen. I think Rajesh is frozen. So let's wait for Rajesh's connection to come back. Rajesh, you're come back now. So go ahead.
Yeah, so I think if you are able to correct it intra-articularly, you'll know the way the anatomical axis will come and hit inside the joint, then you can do it. And you make your cut accordingly. by shifting your center of entry point a little bit more medially in a valgus knee. But if you're not, then you'll have to do an extra articular correction first.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Yeah, and yeah. One more question here, Hemant. When one chooses to use the lateral parapetlar approach for valgus knee?
Anybody from the panel has any experience with lateral parapetlar? I've never used a lateral parapetlar.
I did it in a couple of cases many years back because Peter Kiblish, I used to do LCSE and Peter Kiblish published that. But I found it that there's no extra advantage. In fact, you're looking at the joint completely in a different way. Everting the patella is very difficult. You almost peel it off from the tibial tuberosity attachment. So I've given it up.
Yeah, it is tough. Move on.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks, Rajesh. Next is Dr. Indrajit Sardar from Kolkata. He is going to talk about fixed flexion deformities. Indrajit, all over to you. You can share your screen now. Right.
Can you see it? Hello?
Yes, we can see
your
screen.
Yeah, no. Okay. So, Tikyan, fixed flexion deformity, and we all know what a fixed flexion deformity is as opposed to a quadriceps leg. So, that's a knee which is unable to fully extend to zero or either actively or passively. And why the fixed flexion deformity is undesirable is because of the lack of full extension of the knee results in greater force of the quadriceps and greater forces of energy and limp, results in a slower walking velocity, abnormal gait mechanics, especially overloading the contralateral limb, and the residual flexion contractures after TK have been associated with poorer function scores and outcomes. The causes are basically bony impingement, posterior capsular contracture, hamstring shortening, and ligament contracture. But it has been seen that the patients with a preoperative fixed flexion deformity shows continued improvement in their fixed flexion up to 10 years post-arthroplasty, and of similar outcomes to those with no preoperative fixed flexion. So the first thing is that you've got to visualize posteriorly, and one of the techniques after your media cuts is to expand it by lamina spreaders on one side, and then you can see the other side properly. And and you can release on that side as well. I'll go to that one a little later also. So the posterior bony impingement, the osteophytes and all have to be released from there at the back. And so many things come out of that bare little corner, especially in this flexion deformity. And of course, you have to put your femoral implant, avoid putting it in flexion because that's going to cause a lot of problems. The correct entry of the femoral rod, which is very basic. The grades of the fixed flexion deformity was Lombardi's classification, 0 to 15, 15 to 30, and something more than 30. But generalized, the severe fixed flexion deformity will be something more than 45. There's a logarithm out there in the literature. So basically, the first four things that you do is over there, you remove the posterior osteophytes, you reestablish the posterior recess, you release the posterior capsule, and then do your PCR trial. And if there's a flexion contracture present still, that is, your flexion gap is more than the extent. So then you resect up 2 millimeters additional distal femur, and again do your PCR trial. And once you have the PCR trial, if there's no FC, the extension flexion gaps are same, the posterior cruciate ligament tension is appropriate, you do the implant. And the otherwise, if there is a flexion contracture present, then this is the flexion gap is even more than the extension gap, and you treat it as grade 2. And otherwise down, you assess the tibial slope, insufficient slope, then you can do a little bit more. And as Evan said, you can do the anterior part a little bit more sometimes. Then do the PCR trial. There's no FC, so these are equal. Partial release of the PCL. PCL, PCR trial again, and the tight or incompetent PCL. Then you go on to the grade 2. In the grade 2, you remove the same stuff over there in the beginning. Then you do your PS trial. And if your extension gap is greater than your flexion gap, the flexion gap is greater than your extension gap, you do additional femoral resection, and there is no fixed contracture, both the gaps equal, you can go and implant your PS. And the PS is there because the CR knees, it's better for the PS people to do it there because most of the time the PCL is there. But then there are opinions to the contrary, and many persons who are enamored of the CR will do it for a longer time, will strive with it for a longer time, and will use it. And finally, the grade 3, again, you do all this thing. You reduce, apart from that, you resect the additional distal femur to allow the insertion of the prosthesis. Do your trial. It's stable. This is the implant. You do it. And if it's still unstable, then you can think of a rotating hinge. Not that you have to do it all the time, and you have to keep it in your armamentarium on the table. So grade 1 flexion deformity, this is the release of the posterior side. The release of the medial side as it goes on. We use an osteotome sort of thing there and over there going on to the whole thing. It's extra periosteal, of course. And then the grade 1 flexion deformity over here, we can go right down to the back as much as possible. And releasing. Again, the meniscus that is there, the meniscus of you, of course, you have to remove it fully using a coagulation thing over there.
What is the deal for me?
The whole thing is that taking off the whole meniscus this time in the fixed flexion deformity is essential. Some leave a little rim behind, but even then we try and take it, most of it is off in the fixed flexion deformity, not leaving anything behind. And then going off to the lateral side. And hurrying it on, as we all know that it can be done. Now, the grade 2 flexion deformity, at the end of all the above releases, if extension gap is smaller than the flexion gap, then the distal femur resected by 2 millimeters, as you said. But if you should do a PCL, there is a school of thought which says you go on to the distal femur resect by more than 4 millimeters. So that can be, but that can lead to a posterior cruciate ligament dysfunction and an elevation of the joint line. The posterior release, of course, as you can see, this is the amount of posterior cut that is done. And over here also, this. And going on, we use this curved osteotome to go all the way around the back, releasing the capsule part of it and then putting a finger in and taking out what the osteophytes are at that. A real good clearance, of course, is necessary for the fixed flexion. And in wanting to do a post-CR to avoid a deep notch cut in size 2 or 1.5, we also at some point try this spike rusting of the posterior cruciate ligament, which is used in some fairly recent cases. And that gives you that little bit of extra leeway when you're trying to release the fixed flexion contracture. Now, the severity of the flexion deformity is the correction. And one of the things is a dynamic splint that is used. And this splint is set at about 1 millimeter or 2 millimeter a day, kept for a day or so, and then again put it, especially at night. So this is one of the ways you can correct your flexion deformity after or before the TKR. These are systems used to use the correct the flexion deformity before you are doing a TKR. And these are problematic if you're doing an ELISARF because it leads to a lot of pin tract inflection and also this pin. So what is severe flexion deformity? Anything more than 45 degrees after anesthesia. And this is the flexion deformity in this case. And you correct before TKR, a serial plaster correction, keeping the dorsal angle free to check pulsation. And we have done quite a lot of it, and some of it have gone on to that extent that we've straightened the knee so well that they've stopped, they're not going in for a TKR. So assess the FFD after the anesthesia under the GA. You must be wary of tibial posterior subluxation. So that's a reason why often we use, when we're correcting it before the TKR, upper tibial Steinman pain or two parallel thick KYs, and of course checking the vascularity all the time. And that's a classical way of doing it. And a CR or a CS, and according to Scott, 98% of TKRs can be managed by CR, but we are not that great. Though we are lovers, we do most of the CRs, but any little problem, we'll go on to a CS. So obviously, you have to choose an implant where you can switch intraoperatively. But the main problem in considering a CR is that a majority of our TKRs are in smaller ladies requiring sizes 1.5 to 2. And one of these box cuts in the systems that we have used will result in this very thin lateral cortex over there, which is very looks very precarious. A patellar resurfacing, we have stopped patellar resurfacing for quite some time now, but they said that the total knee replacement with or without patellar resurfacing, there was a trial and a significant association between knee flexion contracture and anterior knee pain was observed in those knees with patellar resurfacing. So we have stopped doing patellar resurfacing. Not that we do not get knee pain absolutely zero, but it's very tolerable and not much of a complaint with these patients. In the CS knee, the effect of downsizing components intraoperatively because it might lead to an extension laxity. So a downsizing of the femoral component may compromise the postoperative stability of the TKA. And this was done in a cadaveric study. So there are two methods, TKR first for the fixed flexion deformity and then correct. So the TKR first with synovectomy will relieve pain. So then you do the rule of thirds, whatever the flexion contracture is at that time, supposing it's 90 degrees, you correct one third to 60 degrees. And the rest you go on with plaster wedge corrections continuously and physiotherapy. You must use a CS knee in these cases. And you have to make sure that the tibia does not dislocate backwards while you're extending it. It may take up to 3 months or so, but this is the mechanism which we haven't really tried. Now, this is there in the literature, so I put it in, and it requires a loop. This was a 90-degree fixed flexion contracture. This was corrected to 60 degrees fixed flexion contracture. And then after physiotherapy, serial plaster correction, 3 months, this is it. The other side is fixed. So this was the papers which have come out in 2019, 2016. And this is a mechanism which can be used for these. But doing it in this much of 60 degrees fixed flexion contracture, I don't have any experience, but this is one of the mechanisms which can be employed. One of our anesthetists have also been doing this continuous adductor canal block inspired by this. So doing an ultrasound-guided continuous adductor canal block in two patients with severe FCT scheduled for TKR surgery. 70 degrees to 90 degrees ROM reduced to 30 degrees before surgery, which is manageable for this thing. And the one that he did it on, we did get a similar result and which helped us a lot. And this is the mechanism. Now the post-op care is extremely important. So quadriceps exercise, obviously. Focused physiotherapy, specially molded continuous passive motion machine. But again, this has not given continuously good results. A contralateral heel lift is used because the other limb is shortened, and especially if we are doing a unilateral TKR for a fixed flexion deformity and where there's bilateral FFT, then the other side has to have a contralateral heel lift. So that will equalize the limb and will allow your operated knee to straighten out more. You can use splinting. Of course, we use this night splinting and some use traction. But all of these are there in the post-op care and in almost every surgeon's armamentarium where they've got an FFT somehow. But this is the standard exercise that we use. In this side, there's this thing at the back. And not only pulling it, he's contracting the quadriceps and then pushing it down from below. And then only pushing it down from below. And with this 15 degree, 20 degree correction done very well by the physiotherapist, by the patient, has almost reduces the fixed flexion deformity in about a month or so. The post-op, obviously, the polo test and all you have to do so that you're not tight in flexion. And after correction of the flexion deformity, fixed flexion deformity, this is almost coming out well. There's no lift off on this. As you can see, we did a CR on this, and it's quite stable on that. So in total knee replacement, the fundamental thing is that a fixed flexion deformity has to be corrected. There are theories that in the rheumatoid knee, you can leave behind 10 degrees or so and it correct itself. It does so because the rheumatoid ligaments are loose, but that is not in your hands really. You know that it can be done, but it's so much better that if you correct it completely during the surgery on the table. Thank you.
Right, Indrajit, thank you very much for your presentation. Wonderful. I think we can have some questions if there are any. I have a question. When you're talking about the gross deformity correction, say more than 40, 45 degrees, I don't think anybody in today's day and age would be using plaster correction or aiming to correct it post TKR. I think what we really need to achieve is on table, and for that you may actually need a lot more extensive releases. I mean, complete posterior release, maybe even lateral intercostal septum, sometimes even medial release as well if there is gross flexion deformity, and you know, in the end putting a constrained knee. So I think in gross flexion deformities, you would probably be struggling to use, even consider CR. Yeah, Rajesh, you want to say something?
Yeah, absolutely right, Hemant. You might occasionally have released the hamstrings behind Z lengthening of the hamstring capsule, whatever you do, but achieve. I've not used plaster or anything, but I do leave behind, as you say, 10, 15 degrees with rheumatoid patients or inflammatory arthropathy and let them stretch out with the exercises.
Yes,
that's what I think.
Dr. Indrajit, can you go off the screen? Your presentation?
Stop sharing your screen.
I've also, Hemant, can I make a comment?
Yes, of course.
Putting also pin tractions, I've really not found it useful because it's very cumbersome for the patient. So you try to put a pin traction, the patient is not compliant and, you know, it really hardly stretches out. Rather than that, what you were just saying, that intraoperatively do maximal releases, I think that helps. So, you know, I have not had, in the initial time of my practice, I did try to do that, but didn't really do well with the patient's compliance.
Yeah, it's interesting that most people have gone off preoperatively doing something for this flexion deformities. Quite often, like Dr. Indrajit said, once anesthesia is given, a lot of it stretches out and dramatically corrects. And another big issue in inflammatory arthritis is if you take away these inflamed surfaces and put the joints in, they naturally have got a tendency to stretch out and do something on their own. So by and large, this, and also the success of hinged knees to that extent, not that that's the best thing to do. Hinged knees seems to be got better and better with time. So if it is too gross, then one would go with a hinged knee as long as the demands are not too much on the joint. That's how things have turned out. There's one question for Rajesh, if we can go back. The question is, do you have any tricks to deal with lateral popliteal palsy in a gross valgus knee? Do you do anything specific or do you just hope for the best?
No, I think if you have a knee which is fixed
in valgus, sir.
Fixed in valgus and has a flexion deformity, that is the one to worry about.
Yeah.
You want to leave behind, when you have done your surgery, knee in flexion in the recovery and see whether your knee is recovered or not, your lateral popliteal. And if it has, then gradually you can get him into get the patient into extension. Less chance, it'll have that slide in it and have a less chance to have the you will avoid the popliteal palsy. The other thing I have stopped doing is injecting the lateral capsule in that area. Once I've got a lateral popliteal palsy with a local infiltration that I give all around the joint.
That usually resolves.
And it resolves in 2 or 3 days, but still it happened. And then at that time, you don't know why it has happened.
Yeah, your blood pressure goes up for 2 days. So that's...
So But yes, I think the exploration has been described. If you have a palsy, now supposing you get a palsy, then I think you need to immediately get the knee inflection and most of the time hope for the best, because it does recover. Only it takes good 6 months, 9 months to recover. I've had that in one or two patients.
Yeah, one point that needs to be brought out with fixed flexion deformity is the issue of having a mid flexion instability in case you just end up taking extra distal femoral cut without doing any posterior releases at all. So I think Indrajit brought out the point that posterior release has to be done, you know, and before you take out any distal femoral extra bony dissection, the posterior releases have to be really done thoroughly. That was, I think, brought out.
And there's a beautiful study, Hemant, which has nicely demonstrated the taking away the distal femur by 2 mm more. Yeah, and it doesn't give that kind of a correction for extension. It's much better to go soft tissue way. Absolutely. And as a last resort, just those few degrees, maybe with the distal femoral cut. Yeah.
Right. I think let's move on to the last presentation. That's by Dr. Parag Sancheti. He's going to tell us how he deals with gross laxity and hyperextension. Over to you, Parag.
Yeah. Thanks very much, Hemant. It's indeed an honor to be here on this webinar. And we had some excellent talks before. And just to complete the list, I'm going to speak to on gross laxity and hyperextension, and most of the principles were very nicely covered by Hemant in his introductory talk. So it's just going to be a little repetition of some of the principles and a few more nuances. I think whenever we are dealing with hyperextension, it's not a very commonly seen deformity. The incidence would be less than 5%, and the posterior capsule gets overstretched. And many a times the associated ligaments, the ACL, PCL, over a period of time, can become incompetent and get attenuated. We need to find out whenever we are dealing with a hyperextension that what is the cause of the hyperextension, because that itself will dictate a lot of things. Is it because of the insufficient anterior bony stock? Is it post-traumatic? Is it because of some neuromuscular disorders? Or is it just a post-infective CQD? So that particular cause of hyperextension needs to be identified, and if it is a neuromuscular cause, then probably you've got to think of what implant to use, how much constraint to add. Also, many a times we see gross laxity. Again, the incidence of gross laxity patient is less than 1% in my practice, and those are the figures which we also see in the literature. Here, it's not just the posterior capsule which is lax, it's generalized laxity you see in both the planes, the coronal plane as well as the sagittal plane. And these ones are actually quite difficult to handle. There are many causes which have been described for joint laxity, and sometimes these syndromes which come, the Marfan's, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, this necessarily may not destroy the bone and the patient may not be symptomatic. You treat the patient only very symptomatic with joint laxity. Some of them adapt so well that they don't really come forward with pain and they don't come with grotesque deformities and don't really need a knee replacement. But some of them, especially the neuropathic ones, the Charcot joints, they need to be tackled because they come with a lot of deformity and disability. The pain element is not as much as we know in these grossly looking deformed neuropathic joints. In this neuropathic joints, it's difficult to diagnose, but it is a progressive degenerative condition. There is bone resorption, leads to loss of sensations, gross deformities. And it's very important to identify the cause. Sometimes you may not find any cause at all, but at times there can be a underlying diabetes. There may be a patient may have had syphilis, syringomyelia. And so you need to really rule out what is the exact cause of neuropathic, if at all you can. And we need to investigate these patients further. So how do you manage these patients who have laxity in their joints, who have hyperextension deformities? In these, it's very important to have a detailed history and a conversation with the patient to understand their expectations. Because at times these patients, when we operate on them, have a high incidence of complications. So they need to understand, and their expectations have to be realistic after we really do surgery for them. Proper evaluation and documentation of these conditions is quite important. Many of them have their altered gaits. And again, as I said, we will not be able to pin a cause to the exact cause of the severe gross laxity, and at times even a biopsy may be useful. These EMG nerve conduction studies, especially the nerve conduction studies, are pretty useful, and one can come to a diagnosis with these. And I recommend that, you know, we do a EMG and a nerve conduction studies in all the patients in whom we are suspecting neuropathic joints. Once we analyze the X-ray of these neuropathic joints, they have either a hypertrophic kind of a pattern or an atrophic pattern. And at times it can be mixed. So whenever there is a hypertrophic joint, there is osseous sclerosis, we may see osteophytes. While in atrophic joint, there is more bone resorption and it can simulate the condition of post-septic sequelae. The bones will be destroyed. There will be distended joints. There is increased density of the bones. There is debris which is lying around, disorganization of the joint. And at times, the patient may come with dislocation. So remember these 6 days when you're analyzing the X-rays of these patients. I find it very important that we take and full-length X-ray, because sometimes these have patients have pathological fractures. They may have extra-articular deformities too, and there may be some other pathologies up there. And therefore, short films in these cases are definitely contradicted. You have to take long-length films because you've got to really plan these difficult cases well. Stress X-rays are again important because they will tell you how much the deformity is correctable. So it kind of prepares you what to expect when you go inside. And because these are very lax joints and they don't have fixed deformities, you know, these patients, they are globally unstable and move in both the planes, AP and lateral, the severe ones. I like this particular classification by Arun Mulaji, and it divides the laxity into three. Type 1, where it is only in one plane, the coronal can be medial or lateral. Type 2 is either coronal 1, that is the medial or lateral, along with the sagittal, the posterior plane laxity. And type 3 are the, you know, ones which have a global instability and global laxity all around. The principles are very important and they have been very nicely outlined in the first talk by Hemant, but this will be just a repetition. You have to keep the cuts to the minimum. You know, the transfer of collateral ligaments, as Rajesh showed that, you know, we can transfer the medial or the lateral collateral femoral attachments and, you know, correct these and get actually more strenuous from moving them distally or to move them proximally. We have to understand when to undersize the femoral component, because what happens is in this, unlike the flexion deformities, you have the extension space, which is much more than the flexion space. So we have to probably, you know, undersize the distal femoral component and then use a thicker poly. Of course, you have to have the constrained processes. What happens in the hyperextension is that sometimes the ligaments become incompetent, and then it may be difficult to balance with just a PS knee. CR knees in these questions is in these cases out of question. We have to understand and plan if there's a reversal of tibial slope, which is especially seen in hyperextension deformities, especially following an HTO, if at all that has been done. Again, I cannot overemphasize this point. You know, do not cut more bone to compensate for the bone defects, which also will be seen along with these hyperextension and grossly lax joints. We have to have a balanced knee in flexion as well as an extension. And as far as possible, try and have a match between the flexion and the extension gaps. I think that is important. In this, what happens is your extension gap is actually a little more than the flexion gaps, and you've got to do various tricks to balance them. One will always be faced with bone defects, and if at all there is bone available through your proximal tibial cut and distal femoral cut, you can use them, or then have access to allografts, because that is something which you may require. And otherwise, then you'll have to keep ready augments and wedges. This is one of my cases. This was a neuropathic joint. This was a 55-year-old lady, a bilaterally affected joint. We could not identify exactly what she had, diabetes, so probably diabetic neuropathy. We did the first side, one to a bilateral, but because of the associated comorbidities, we just did one at a time. This was a LCCK implant, and then the right one was done after a month, and this was a 3-month follow-up, and then the patient who came bedridden on a wheelchair could walk pretty well. So I think to have that constraint process is ready is important. This was another patient, again, cross laxity. You can see the bone loss, and the patient did not have much sensation, not much pain. And we started off thinking that we'll do an LCCK, but on the table we found that the collaterals were also incompetent, especially the medial collateral, and therefore we converted to doing a hinge. And I particularly like the link prosthesis, which has a little posterior hinge, but is quite an easy joint to do and not as expensive as the other RHKs or Noel's hinge, which we have in the armamentarium. And this was the final X-ray. This was another case, again, grossly unstable, lax in all the joints. This was the kind of a grade 3 laxity. Again, we took minimal bony cuts and then used hinge processes, the link one, as you can see. This is the final X-ray and the patient did well. So I think it's important to understand that, you know, we have to have the proper constraint ready. These are the patients who can have high rate of complications, and that has been described in the literature. They can be periprosthetic fractures because the bones are osteoporotic, aseptic loosening. The longevity of these joints is much less, so we have to explain that to the patients. I have seen one patient of having a quadriceps tendon rupture, so one has to be really careful, and these complications have to be explained. So whenever you're dealing with gross laxity, with hyperextension deformities, you've got to really understand that what is the pathology. You've got to have the skill sets. You know, it should not be one of your cases which you start with to do, because these are a little difficult cases, and you should have everything ready in your armamentarium. You should have the highest level of constraint ready, the hinge if required. But most of the times, as again Hemant said, you know, these patients can be managed well with a PS, with a stem, or at the most you may have to go to a TC3 or a LCCK, and of course you have to keep the proper inserts ready. So in summary, friends, I would like to say that these patients, initially we thought that they can be a contraindication, and initially in my practice I used to turn them away, but now we are definitely got the know-how, the expertise that knee replacement can be done. Of course, the longevity is less, there are more complications, and you have to keep all constraint processes ready. Again, the important thing is that these patients have a longer post-operative rehab period, especially patients who have hyperextension. You know, at times it's better to leave them in slight hyperextension if they have 10 degrees and leave them in 2 degrees, because it's important for their stance phase. And then again, the patient has to be counseled that they may have higher complication rates. So they are definitely doable. They require to be tackled in a particular way, and the sequence of surgeries is not difficult as long as you understand that. Keep the bony cuts to the minimum, not too much of releases are required, and constraint processes may be required. Thank you very much for your attention, and thanks, Hemant, for the opportunity.
Thanks, Parag. That was wonderful, and I think you covered all the aspects of this difficult problem. I think one of the biggest problems, biggest challenges that one faces in such scenarios, if a patient has overt neurological issues. And such patients, I think the question is whether we offer them surgery, even maybe with a hinge, or, you know, without, we try not to use a hinge. The problem is if you use a hinge and you have a hyperextension stop with those hinges, even that is going to wear out with in course of time. So that is the biggest worry. No, if that sort of thing happens, then what else are you left with as an option if that happens? You know, the longevity of that implant is an issue. You any comments on that?
Yeah, definitely, because you want to try and use the less level of constraint on one side, but at the same time, you have a fear of, you know, that wearing out and again, you know, becoming loose. So you, there is such a trade-off, and that trade-off is the longevity. So, but one good thing what I've seen about these patients is their requirements are less, you know, and they are not really high demand patients, and therefore they tend not to do more activities, unlike our other conventional TKR patients. So, but I think that you have to tell the patients and have a balance between the amount of constraint you use. You know, it's not necessary that you go straight away to a hinge. So,
one point about link prosthesis. I love that prosthesis as well. Yes. But if you have hyperextension and using a link which has got the hinge at the back, that has not done very well in the past. Absolutely. So for all of the reasons, link prosthesis is fantastic. But for hyperextension deformities, one needs to be really watchful about that.
Yeah, link does not have that hyperextension bumper stop, whereas RHK has that by extension bumper stop.
Yeah.
Absolutely, that's a very valid point, Sharan. And you know, what I just spoke to Burwa, they are trying to design some new processes, and he's helping them out. Yeah. And this is one of the points they are working on at the moment.
Just one question for Rajesh. Sorry. Can I just fill in? There's one question for Rajesh. When you said you'll release your hamstrings in your approach, do you release them separately or do you do it through the arthrotomy?
No, separately.
Separately.
The medial hamstring is what I release. And separately, like you would do, you know, we learned it for CP or other, where you take a posterior incision along the tendon and do a lengthening.
Okay. But is it done the same stage or you do it before?
So I've done both. Most of the earlier I used to do earlier and try and stretch out the knee, but that doesn't work as much as do it at the time of the operation. Two incisions. At the end of your correction, if you think you've got enough, fine. If you think the hamstrings are still tight, then I would do it and do it through a separate incision.
Yeah, I've done it through a separate posterolateral incision. I've done the biceps lengthening and I've actually used, medial hamstrings I could release too. So I don't need a separate incision for medial hamstring release. But for the lateral side, yes, I've taken a separate posterolateral incision and done that biceps release there.
Just a question from Dr. Parag. Yes. Have you followed them, the hyperextension deformities, how they have behaved after a couple of years?
So the longest experience I have is now for 11 years. I had done one in 2009 and they do well. The hyperextension one, if they're isolated hyperextension deformity, they do well.
Without neurological issues.
Yeah.
I think Dr. Inderjeet has got a question about the polio. How do you do with arthritic polio limb, which has got hyperextension and not such great quadriceps? What's your answer for that?
Yeah. So this is one of my relative contraindications, because what I have seen is these patients are actually quite well settled. They do quite well. And pain is never a problem in these patients. You know, but just because of they read somewhere and they come ahead with surgery, I have done two patients. And again, in these, we have to use a hinge. And it depends on how much quadriceps power they have. If they have zero quadriceps power, then that's a problem, because then you have to deal with them. And then, as we discussed, we cannot use the hinge, which I like to use the link. They have to go in slight hyperextension. There has to be that anterior bumper block. And then probably an RHK is better. In one, I've used a hinge. That patient didn't do quite well, and one I used an RHK. I found that slightly better than the link, especially for this hyperextension in polio. But I'm not a very big fan of talking my patients into total knee replacement with polio patients with hyperextension and quadriceps zero.
Yeah, that's a difficult problem. I think TKR in polio with quadriceps zero is a difficult problem, but it's doable, can be done. Yeah, Rajesh, you want to say something?
Yes, so I think a lot of the polios, I used to get worried, and I think as Parag said earlier, that their activity level may be different, and that's how there's usually not a problem of their losing in a quick post-operative period. But the hyperextension is a worry. It's the highest level of neurology where it is quadriceps is zero. It is going to transmit the forces at the fixation. So you want to really have a very good fixation, maybe even sleeves if you want to have it. And it does work if their activity level overall is grossly
less. Rajesh, one of the interesting things in polio, if they don't have quadriceps, but they are awfully painful for whatever reason, the arthritis is bad, then one, if you have to do any replacement in them, whatever prosthesis you use, you may have to use an external support, like something like a caliper, where it locks and it stays like that. They move around comfortably, but they're traveling in public transport. They have to sit down. They unlock it and sit down. They don't have pain. The disability remains similar, but the pain is not there. It's a very relative, each patient is different, and really you have to see, look at the need and customize for that situation.
One point to note is that these patients are actually walking with hyperextension as the way of locking their knee. Because it's no quadriceps.
Yes.
So they actually swing their leg, lock the knee in hyperextension with a heel strike, and that is the way they walk. The last thing you want to do for these patients is leave them with a flexion deformity. because then they can't lock their knee and they can't walk.
Yeah, they'll curse you.
So they will curse you if you leave them with even 5 degrees of flexion deformity. So actually hyperextension, maybe 5 degrees of hyperextension, you may leave them in.
Absolutely.
I think it's time to move on now to the cases presentation. I think following these wonderful presentations, I thank all the faculty members. The first is Dr. Ravi Kumar from Bangalore. Over to you, Dr. Ravi Kumar.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can share your screen.
Yeah. Do it now. Yeah. Good evening, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. I'm Dr. Ravi Kumar, Associate Surgeon with Dr. Sharan Patil since 13 years, working for Spurge Group of Hospital. The complex primary knee as such has been defined as the TKR done on previous surgeries or severe deformities in any plane, stiff knee, extra-articular deformity, or post-HTO. Dealing with such knees where the total knee replacement is done, the complication rate is more. It may rise from 5 to 41%. So today I'll be dealing with a case where we have done a 65-year-old gentleman complains over left knee pain since 2 years. He has disability and restriction of the activities of daily living. He has been operated by HTO 20 years ago for the medial compartmental OA. He presented to us with no signs of any infection, varus deformity of 15 degrees, tenderness over the joint line, and painful range of movements from 0 to 90 degrees, and grade 1 laxity. This was his X-ray where the previous STO medial compartmental for medial compartmental OA was done with extremely severe pain. So he was able to bend his knee around 90 degrees, but with pain.
90?
Yeah. Around 90 degrees. So then we intraoperatively we did.
Why don't you just go back to the preoperative X-ray and then maybe we can discuss a few things there.
That range of movement is definitely more.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, what are your problems here that you are expecting looking at this X-ray? I mean, obviously the hardware will come out. It looks like a non-union there. And, you know, this sort of non-union you wouldn't expect with high tibial osteotomy. So I'm not sure whether it was high tibial osteotomy or it's something else.
This was the history, what he had, sir. Like, we also initially thought it may be a fracture where it wasn't fixed. So, but when we went through his discharge summary, which was like 20-year-old, it was written, it's a previous STO done for the medial compartmental OA, and there was no history of trauma.
Because if you look at the osteotomy, non-union of that fragment that is, you know, sitting in the maybe anterior half of the tibial plateau.
I can't agree with you more, Hemant, if you look at it. And also, if you do a high tibial osteotomy, you don't generally do that kind of a plate on the medial side. If you have opened a wedge and then you don't have screws all over that so closely also, you'll at least keep it at a distance. It looks like it was done for something else. Yeah.
Right. So what was your plan, Dr. Ravi Kumar?
Yeah. Initially, I mean, one more important concern was removal of the hardware, which is 20-year-old. And second, any signs of infection, because it was all good for 18 years. Suddenly, 2 years, it was like a slow, low-grade infection, which we ruled out with other biochemical parameters, which were normal. And second were medial collapse and also rotational deformity. And fourth was probably non-union of a tibial tuberosity fragment or the anterior fragment. While doing the surgery, whether this tuberosity fragment may come out after doing primary cuts. That was our concern. So we were prepared.
What was the quadriceps power to begin with? Was he able to do fully extension kick?
His quadriceps power was 5x5. And he was able to do All the activities, extension, yeah, complete extension with active extension.
All right, let's move on.
Yeah. So then we ruled out the infection and this was his range. And intraoperatively, we found that as discussed in the X-ray, that the TBL, anterior part of the TBL after the primary cut, along with the TBL tuberosity was almost like a fibrous union. Then we held with pins and did a primary TBL cut. Then did a total knee replacement, then fixed with cancellous screws, 3 cancellous screws. So like post-operatively, it was uneventful. This was the immediate post-operative X-ray. Then 5 days later, we inspected the wound. There was skin issues on the medial aspect wherever the implant was there. So, and when you go through the literature also, the article recently... Sorry, sir, the lateral aspect. And when you go through the literature also, the wound issues in terms of infection, DVT, or complication rates are more compared when previously existing implants are previous interventional arthritis. Like the arthritis is developed post-intervention. When you are converting them for a TKR, the complication rates are more in terms of wound infection, DVT, and deep joint infections. So then, and also the incidence of surgical site complications are also around 8.3% with yet other literature. So then we immobilized the knee for 3 weeks and the wound settled, started an ROM exercises. He was doing pretty well and forced 75 days later, he came back with a dry sinus and it was not discharging anything, but there was probably due to maceration of the skin secondary to the washers. This was his X-ray at that time and this was the dry sinus. Once again, clinically there was no signs of infections elsewhere other than the dry sinus, and also the biochemical parameters were normal. Then we decided to debride it, removed all the screws and debrided it and did a primary closure. So once again, going back to the literature, previous interventional arthritis, the readmission, 90 days readmission rate is quite high compared to the TKR done on osteoarthritis. This then immobilized for 2 more weeks and the wound healed, the debrided wound, and followed him till 4 months. The tibial tuberosity segment also was gelling up and he was doing extremely well, good ROM. Then we followed every 6 monthly for first 2 years, then every yearly the next 2 years. This is now 4 years now. Complete good healing up of the tissues, good functional outcome. So presently this is his 4 year post-op with good ROM, good cordyceps mechanism and pain-free lifestyle. So this is the latest gait cycle video.
That's wonderful outcome and congratulations on wonderfully done case. Just a couple of questions that we may bring up.
Yes.
Would you in retrospect have considered doing this in 2 stages? First stage as implant removal and second stage going ahead with the TKR. Do you think that was could have been better, or you think this was because it worked well, you're happy with it?
In the differential diagnosis, we kept differential diagnosis, maybe a low-grade infection also, but the biochemical parameters were normal, first point. Second, intraoperatively, we thought like if any signs of any infections or anything, would have once again staged it. And third.
I think, Hemant, can I make a point?
Yes, of course.
I think the point here is, Ravi Kumar, that there is no infection, but in a situation where there is an implant so close to the skin, there is little non-union, particularly on the tibial side, many of us would consider taking the implants out first and see that everything is, I would have probably now with that non-union in mind and the plate screws being so near there onto the skin, it would not have been a bad idea to do it in 2 stages, just to take the implants out, ensure everything.
I think it's the principle that's perfectly. Whenever there are implants inside, consider it infected unless put otherwise. Rajesh, very interesting. No, it's close to the skin.
Even if it's not infected, around the tibia, if you have a big plate, this was not too big on multiple screws, but still, in retrospect, maybe that was a good thing. In what would you have, again in retrospect, thought bony fragment without putting those screws, because they were pretty much under the skin and probably tenting your skin, and maybe there was some.
It's a very good point you make. So there are two. It just requires. Yeah, just two things which puzzled us about this case. One is, if you decided to do in two stages, you pull out all the implants, what would you do with that loose fragment? So that fragment is not too small. We have to get that to stay there. You would have, again, put some implants to hold that fragment, because if you take away that fragment, a good chunk of the tibial platform is gone. And because it is a fibrous union along, almost involving the tibial tubercle, it is a little tricky situation. Again, a fixation, again, taking out. And whether you can put any...
Was that implant holding that fibrous fragment? It wasn't. Your quadriceps no. was working very well. That
No, exactly. Your quadriceps is working well. I'm talking about the tibial platform itself. The tibial platform itself, you need to freshen it up and get it to integrate in some way, because that chunk was significant. If you had to leave it like that till the second stage, maybe you could think about that. But that was a little bit of a concern. That fragment, yeah.
But it's a matter of, you know, you could go in at about 3 weeks or 2.5-3 weeks.
Probably.
Okay. I mean, it has worked well. So, points taken. And I think all in all, a good outcome in the end.
No, but I think the main thing is when it's subcutaneous implants so close, and one needs to really be paranoid and worried about good doing this. And especially if people have comorbidities, health of the patient is not great and all that, it's always safer. In fact, we've got a good series, Rajesh, where we have done it as two stage. You take away the implants. You do it like an infected situation, even if it is not infected. Do the cuts, put a spacer, wait, and take away, clean it up nicely, and then do a totally. I don't know if it is published, but we have got a small series of doing things like that. Yeah,
we've done that in some cases, and it's with the JBJS case report at the moment.
Right.
So the way I assess is that this is mainly a problem with the implants which are under the skin on the lateral side, because lateral flap is always under the left of blood supply.
Yeah.
The way I check it is that you try and pick up the skin and see if it is how adherent it is to the implants under that. If that skin is very tight, that is the skin you worry about. If there is some mobility to the skin and the subcutaneous tissue, then you are likely to get away with it.
Yeah.
Any puckering of the scar to the bone itself, it's a bad sign. So a bad sign, you know, should, I think, be done in two stages. If really puckered scar adherent to the bone.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So that's the implant. Pucker to the implant.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Ravi Kumar. That's well presented. Yes. The next we have Dr. Vikash Kapoor from Kolkata. If you can stop sharing your screen.
Yes, sir.
Vikas, can you share your screen and present the case? Thank you.
Yeah. So there we are, and so my submission
we
would.
We can't see your screen.
But I have shared my screen just now.
Yes,
just
a minute. Hang on, it's not come up yet.
I'm not sure. Just can somebody?
Yeah, share screen at the bottom in the middle.
No, Vikas, just stop sharing now. Stop sharing and share again. Then, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Coming on now. Yeah. Yeah. Go on.
Perfect.
Wonderful.
So, this with so much of complex deformities already discussed, and so many things about beautifully discussed about the hinge knees and restraints and constraints, we go back to the simple CR knee in bad varus, and there are various shades of varus which we have, as you can see, and which we deal with. And most of them can be dealt with the retaining knee. And as you see, it looks like a very innocuous varus of, say, 25 degrees or so. But here on the lateral view, a simple-looking varus may have a runoff on the medial side, which may not be very discernible in AP views at all. And sometimes in lateral views also may be missed. So, as you see, this knee, we do a standard sort of medial release as we open the knee. And this is being done, all the knees are done, most of them are without tunique, primarily the primary knees. So, you do this medial release initially after giving the incision and take out the meniscus on the medial side. And once we take out the meniscus on the medial side, we kind of... start seeing the deformity on the medial side, and look at this the virus, which seemed to be so innocuous when we saw the X-ray, has a huge runoff and a big osteophyte chunk on the posterior medial aspect. And once we take it out on the medial side, we will see that. So here you can see that. Once we have done that, we have done the subluxation, and I'll just skip some steps, and we are doing the osteophyte removal on the medial side. Once we do the osteophyte removal on the medial side, since I have planned the cruciate retaining knee, I check my cruciate, posterior cruciate, with the help of a test which I do by injecting some saline into the posterior cruciate ligament and making it balloon up. So at this point of time, I know my posterior cruciate ligament is functional and is intact. I can discuss this test later on if somebody wants. Then we take our tibial cut with the minimalistic cut on the medial side. And as you can see, so much of medial bone has not really come out in the cut. Once we have taken the cut, we can see the runoff on the medial side and a huge amount of posteromedial osteophyte or a chunk of bone, which is hanging out and causing the deformity and tenting of the medial collateral ligaments, which the soft tissue sleeve is removed from the posteromedial aspect, and below this whole chunk of bone, right back posteriorly, just like in any other deformity of severe varus and posteriorly. Now, the next step is that after doing the femoral cuts, the tibia is aligned to the tibial, to the foot. And then I mark this tibia out along with this, and we see, and also match it with my posterior cruciate ligament. At the same time, see the anterior alignment of the plate with the foot. And then once we have done this, we are ready to, we know how much bone extra is on the medial side. And then it is complete carpentry with the help of your osteotome and hammer. You take out, maybe a bit brave for some people, but this is how it can be removed completely. This is an extra bone which kind of doesn't need to be there, and it was tenting the medial collateral ligament in most of the cases in severe varus. So once we take this out, we realize the huge amount of release which happens by itself, and as yet the posterior cruciate ligament is still intact and it's quite pretty good. So, as you see, this with the broader osteotome, we take it out. It is acting as a release as well as kind of, taking out the extra bone. So, once we do this, this bone comes out. The good part is that it may be feared that our MCL might get compromised, but I'll show you how the MCL is completely unaffected with this maneuver. Once we do this, there is obviously a large chunk of bone which has come out, and our tibia looks very, very decent now. The cut tibia, the prepared tibia, which is already there. And here I am palpating the MCL with the help of my finger, making sure that all things are good. Medially, you can see that femur also has a similar kind of osteophyte which needs to be removed. By doing that, we are kind of debulking the femur also, sometimes to some extent, so that it matches the tibia at this point of time. And it's now looking quite decent. Once you have done this, we do the standard posterior release. Most of these terrible varus have a large amount of flexion also, maybe sometimes 10 to 15 to 20 degrees. So here we see now we have repaired our cruciate retained knee, and now with the help of just an 8 millimeter spacer, we go ahead and do the check balances without even holding the spacer, and the laxity is completely gone. There is no laxity. There is a complete, you can do full range of motion even without the knee. So technically, if you are able to preserve your PCL and test it properly, and you do your resection properly, marking it out nicely, you are able to resect minimal amount of bone and correct a deformity of as much as 30 degrees. Now, here you can see there is a small gap remaining between the plate and the remaining amount of runoff on the tibia, which is, of course, a standard technique of putting in the screw as a support to the tibial base plate along with cement. So screw plate cement, cementing is done. The screw is put in a straight line just to act as a pillar to the plate, which is a very standard procedure followed by most of us. And once we do this, it is about less than 5 millimeter depth which is needed, and then this screw is indicated. Again, since I have tested it before, I retest my PCL by giving about 5 to 10 ml of saline. It swells up, as you can see, very nicely. It becomes a big balloon structure, retaining all the fluid. And that shows the integrity of my PCL besides the posterior drawers test. So here, again, once we have put in our standard tibial implant, with which is going in, without any extender at this point of time, because the stability with the help of just a spacer was so good that you don't really feel that you need any kind of spacer. And with less than 5 millimeter of defect on the medial side, the spacer use is negated and constraint level is brought down to very minimal, and retained cruciate gives you a reasonable kinematics. And as you can see, after doing this surgery, this is the kind of stability you get even in a pretty bad varus and fixed flexion deformity of more than 30 degrees. And this is the final X-ray, which it looks like. So friends, I think thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you, Vikas.
And I hope it makes some sense.
Yeah, I mean, you brought out 2 points very nicely. One was the reduction osteotomy that was done on the tibial side. That alone is enough. So you did not need to increase the constraint just by reduction osteotomy alone. And second point, obviously, you brought out was the posterior femoral osteophyte release also is pretty important in these cases, because that also contributes to the medial contracture.
Yeah,
and I think having done both of these things, I think, you know, CR or PS could be a personal choice, but you could even do a CR. So that's really heartening.
Parag calls me a dagabaz all the time for this. For the last 10 years, one decade, I have shifted to the CR knees and have been in that league of where 98% figure was quoted for somebody doing CR knees. So that is where I stand at this point of time.
Yeah, that's shifted. Loyalties.
Yeah, no, not just shifting. I'm loyal to you, not to this.
No, but it's fair. I think in the deformity, you know, complex deformity webinar, it's important to bring out the point that you really need to start at the bottom of the pyramid as far as the constraints go, and you could still do it in a case that looks complex, but, you know, as you go along, don't jump to the higher level of constraints, and I think be ready to use what you routinely normally use.
Just a quick point, Hemant, because that was beautifully shown. Just one point which I have shifted over a period of time is you put those screws in the defect. You said you put the screws straight down. And especially if you're using two of them or three of them, and if you put them straight, they are almost exiting the lateral cortex. Yeah. It could form a breach of the cortex. It's a good idea to angle it in
so
that they don't go towards the medial cortex.
Use a straight screw. So right. Two, I angle it by about 15 to 20.
How you use your screw, but that's fine. Yeah.
Well, personal choices.
Thanks, Vikas. Wonderful presentation. Thank you. Next is Dr. Rajkumar from Coimbatore. And let's over to you, Raj.
Yes, sir. Okay. Good evening, everyone. I hope I'm audible.
You're good.
Yeah. Good evening, and I would like to thank Dr. Hemant for giving me this opportunity and inviting me to present this case. This is a 74-year-old male. As you can see here, he has got a severe varus deformity with pain and difficulty in walking on the left side. 25 degrees of fixed flexion deformity, morbidly obese patient. And as expected in an obese patient in Indian scenario, patient is diabetic, hypertensive, ischemic heart disease, and he's on treatment. So many cardiac drugs. So he came in a wheelchair, not able to even stand and walk without any support. With a lot of difficulty, he was walking in this video. So just to highlight some history related to this whole case, 16 years back, he sustained a fracture in the leg, left leg, in 2004. And this was the immediate post-operative X-ray with a nail in the tibia. And 1 month later, the surgeon noted a fracture in the proximal tibia. Probably, I don't know what exactly happened, probably a missed fracture in the immediate post-operative period. And 1 month later, he saw this. And subsequently, he treated that fracture with the plaster. And then 3 months later, 2 months, 3 months, and finally, these were the X-rays which I had collected from him. And 1 year later, it showed union with a mal union in the proximal tibia. And 13 years follow-up, the nail inside the tibia with mal union. And this is the presenting X-ray. So if you look at this X-ray, like as we saw clinically, severe varus, bone loss, mal union at the proximal tibia, FFD, obesity. Okay. For all practical purposes, blood investigations, we ruled out infection. So there is no infection. And this is a standing X-ray. And this is the X-ray of the whole leg, tibia, AP and lateral. So difficulties, yes, severe varus, obesity, 25 degrees of FFD, bone loss, extra-articular deformity and old nail in situ. So as we all expect, there needs a lot of planning in this case. So let us see the questions which has to be answered in the planning. So I'd like to discuss with this with the panel. Oh, sorry. Panel, what will be their opinion on the planning? Like the questions to be answered, like whether a single stage or a two-stage intra-articular or an extra-articular correction, bone loss management and navigation.
I think first thing, Rajkumar, if we have to figure out whether this deformity can be, this extra-articular deformity can be dealt with intra-articularly. Those lines, yeah. What you have drawn, it looks manageable. Maybe you'll end up with a little bit of a, as long as you do not have a big defect, because then you have to stem it if the defect is too big. So there's a fine balance between using a primary without stem and having a small defect. So you have to draw your lines and see whether you are able to manage it or not. That's what would worry me more than anything else.
I accept that, but regarding the bone loss, see, the bone loss on the medial side is quite big. If you see the standing, I couldn't take a stress view. I always take a stress view in a severe bone loss situation, but in this case, I couldn't take a stress view at all because the knee was stiff.
Right. It was lateral view does not show too much of depression there, but you are saying there was a lot of bone loss. It looks more tilted to me than bone loss medially. Maybe you know better from that view.
I think the, as you say, Saran, this appears to be correctable intra-articularly. There is no doubt. And when you do that, correct it intra-articularly, you're going to be left with a defect on the medial side. And therefore, a standard prosthesis may not be a good idea. So the thing needs to come out. The way I would do this is I would plan in one stage, but with full agreement with the patient that if that nail, which is in there for so many years and after a fracture it has healed, it might not be easy to take that nail out. So I would tell the patient it will all depend on how quickly I can get that nail out. And if I feel good at that time, I would do it in one stage, but with an understanding that if I'm not, I might just do it in two stages. But the nail needs to come out here.
I was about to ask Dr. Rajesh about the option of navigation. Now, I think he won't opt for navigation in this situation if he's doing a single stage.
If I'm doing a single stage, yes. If the nail comes out, I can still use a navigation. There is no problem on navigation for...
I think navigation is not the pertinent problem here, is what the way you look at it. If you can do this without navigating also, but you need space for the stem extension to go in if you have a large defect there. That's the worry, I think.
Rajkumar, I have done the navigation only on the femoral side, because your long stem is going to dictate your alignment. But femoral cut I would do using navigation.
Okay.
Sorry, Hemant, I interrupted you.
No, don't worry. The intra-articular correction, actually, you're going to be left with a huge tibial defect, and you actually practically will end up releasing the medial collateral completely, without which you will not get that correction. And, you obviously will need to go for constrained knee. The issue is whether you want to take out that nail in as a first stage or do it as a second stage. And I would agree with Rajesh that, warning the patient beforehand that you may not do it in one stage is prudent. The question is, see, this seems to be a medial, the nail has been inserted medial to the tibial tuberosity. It is not through the tuberosity.
And
Yeah, that is why it is lower down. It is not higher up, because usually tibial nails, if they're put to the tuberosity or tibial tendon splitting,
more proximal.
It would be more proximal. So this one is much distal.
Hemant, it's also, you should remember, there was a fracture there. There must have been some migration. There is callus formation, all kinds of things. And it is going to be a war removing this nail. It's not
going to
be easy.
Let's hear from Rajkumar what he did.
Actually, in this line only I thought of, like, as everybody said, I was of the opinion that this can be managed intra-articularly, point number one. Point number two, whether single stage or two stage, this way or that way, single stage, yes, it is a better option because of his high risk obesity. The cardiologist also gave him a high risk concern and I told him, I have to take a high risk concern. So I don't want to put him on a two anesthesia for a high risk, two anesthesia. So I wanted to do on a single stage intra-articular correction. But regarding the bone loss management, options were open. So I was thinking how to manage the bone loss without removing the nail, which will be really very difficult. So if you look at the, just for the audience sake, if you look at the whole length alignment, the medial proximal tibial angle has to be drawn and plan accordingly. In this, reasonably, the angle was not way away from the normal angle. So the correction can be achieved intra-articularly, and even the CORA was also 11.4 degrees. But the larger the deformity near the joint line, then it puts a lot of angulation into the joint. So you have to be very, very careful. So if the coronal plane deformity is less than 30 degrees or equal, the intra-articular correction can be done if the CORA is very much away from the joint. So if you look at this article, it's a very good article published. And according to that, in this case, the line passes within the tibial condyle. So I was very much confident that it can be corrected intra-articularly. So what I did. So this was the clinical picture before anesthesia. So this is the flexion deformity with the varus. And once I... I just skipped. So this is the deformity, bone defect on the medial side. So why I didn't attempt the nail initially was because after taking the cuts, everything, initially I took minimal cuts, and after taking the cuts, I thought the nail will be a little bit medial and medial, and it was a little distal. So I thought I could approach the nail after taking the cuts, I can see where the nail entry or somewhere, anywhere that area. So I thought of making some drill holes and enter into the nail. But in this situation, I was not able to, even with the help of the C-arm, I was not able to exactly locate the entry point. So I was not able to really go to the tip of the nail. So what I did was...
Can I interrupt you, Rajkumar?
Yeah.
That the length of the tibial component is also going to be an issue. If you are not going to remove the nail, the length of the tibial component you got to consider, because here you are using PFC. Now, PFC has a fairly long or fairly tall tibial plate.
Yeah, I'm coming to the point now. Right. I'm coming to that point. I know where you're. So, two things. One is that what you're telling about the keel, and the next is that bone loss. So, both needs to be addressed here. So what I did was here to correct the varus deformity and the flexion deformity, I did a reduction osteotomy to correct the varus and also the flexion deformity. This is how the reduction osteotomy was done. And after doing the reduction osteotomy, I was able to approach the posterior aspect, posteromedial of the tibia and the femoral side. Doing the release, I achieved the varus correction, intra-articular correction, and also the flexion deformity was corrected almost near okay. And this was after this all these corrections. Now, if you look at this X-ray, as Dr. Rajesh and Hemant pointed out, the nail was looking very medial. Okay, the entry point was very medial and little bit distal. That was it was looking, but I was unable to locate medially and laterally with the help of C-arm. And finally, after doing a tibial tubercle osteotomy, I found out the nail was sitting exactly below the tibial tuberosity. That is the attachment of the tibial patellar tendon. So just beneath the tibial tuberosity, the nail was there. So you can see that after doing the tibial tubercle osteotomy only, I was able to visualize the nail tip. And this is after doing the osteotomy. So after this, again the challenge started. I couldn't remove the nail at all. I couldn't back it out. I tried all with all the armamentarium I had at the theater, with the help of all slap hammers, everything. It was not even moving even a little bit. So this is how the slot which was there was visible. So what I did was I took a metal cutting bar. I removed the slot, just cut the nail, did the osteotomy of the nail at the slot level. And then this is how I was able to reduce that prominence of the nail proximally. And then this is a metal piece. And then I went ahead, did the preparation for the screw augmentation, which I regularly do like this. And then multiple drill holes for the cementing. The cementing was done. And then I reattached the tibial tubercle osteotomy with the HE bond. And also there was some gap between the tibia and the osteotomy bone. So I packed it with the bone graft there. And this was, and I also put the patient on the plaster for 4 weeks because of the tibial tubercle osteotomy and then the obesity and also some amount of residual mild varus. So because of that, I had to put, I used a cemented stem, 13x30 cemented stem. That was the shortest stem available. So I used that stem. And then after 1 month later, removed the plaster, started knee mobilization. And this was 2 months, just 15 days back, he came for the follow-up. And this was the flexion he was getting. And this is the walking video, 2 months post-op. In fact, I asked him to, since because he was obese, I asked him to use at least a crutch, but he was not, he came walking like this. Thank you.
That's wonderful. I think wonderful outcome. The only question I can ask you is about the fixation of that TTO. I mean, normally you would at least put screws or wires around.
No, Dr. Hemant, can I? All my TTOs I have done only this Ethibond, and it has really given good results in my hands. Like I've seen Ridian Morgan Jones doing this regularly. For all his cases, even in revision scenarios, which he does routinely. And I've never used screws. I've always used Ethibonds.
Right, Rajesh.
Can I ask you, did you try putting the standard component without removing the nail? It appears to me here that you might have been able to do it without even touching the nail.
No, but the thing was, since because he was obese and there is a bone loss medially, somehow I wanted to put at least the smallest stem as much as possible. I tried my best to remove the nail because I can put a proper stem inside.
But did you try putting the standard one first? Did it go? Maybe the long stem, this stem also would have gone, this size stem.
But if you see the lateral view, there is that stem is almost touching that malunited tibial side. So if you want to put a little longer stem, it will breach the cortex posteriorly.
No, I know. But this would have gone maybe without touching the nail. That would have been much better a situation.
A retrospectoscope.
Yeah, exactly. And in fact, you started like that.
It's worked wonderfully, Rajkumar. I think that's having, you know, all the tools in the OT, especially the metal cutting burrs. I think it's a boon.
And I think the biggest tool Rajkumar had is a gag order on the anesthetist in spite of all the high risk. Let him shut up.
I did so much of planning and made sure that everything is there because I expected these kind of things because of the 16-year-old nail inside. But I thought somehow I can remove it. But I managed, but I couldn't remove it at all.
That's a wonderful outcome. I have done leaving that nail in place. I have done a tibial, using standard PS implants. And I've got away with a small gap between the tip of the tibial component and the nail. So I think you could have maybe got away with it here.
Yeah, the only concern was the bone loss and his obesity. I somehow wanted to put a stem. Otherwise, I didn't want one more collapse on the medial side. Then again, high-risk patient coming back. I didn't want to do that.
Fair enough, yeah, that's a wonderful outcome. Thank you very much. Wonderful case, Rajkumar.
Thank you.
Next is Dr. A.S. Prasad from Kanpur. Over to you, sir. You can share.
Okay, I'm sharing my screen. Let me see my presentation. Okay, friends. So the case I'm presenting, I have called it an unusual total knee replacement because it was an unusual case and it is labeled in my collection as one of the unusual presentation. It's a 32-year-old male, a gunshot injury to the knee when he was only 8 years old and was operated, bullet was removed, has lived with the progressive limp because the limp kept on progressive after the surgery, has been shown to famous Elizabeth surgeon because he had a lot of shorting and deformity at the knee. And now he's desperate to get better somehow. And he has been visiting me and pestering me to do something. And I do not know. So ultimately, though he's young, I thought I'll do a knee replacement. And this is what just want to show about the case. It's a fixed varus. TBI is externally rotated. The fixed flexion, which is there, which is again not corrected. And why you can see the gait also, he walks on toes because the shortening is there. It's a fixed flexion deformity, very stable deformity. And it is absolutely not correctable when I'm trying to do a valgus stress test. The flexion is good. In fact, you can sit cross-legged also. And there are two scars which are fixed. And they were a point of worry, but the skin was supple, but however, the tissue inside was also adherent to the deeper structures. And the one was another one was on the lateral thigh also. These are the two scars which were palpable, we could see, but absolutely healed. And this is the X-ray which I saw. So we can appreciate again. The tibia is externally rotated. There's no deformity whatsoever in the femur. There's a medial condylar loss. If we try to see the anteroposterior, the slope is definitely there. But the medial condyle is lost and the slope is again because of a epiphyseal abnormality. The growth has not happened to the extent it should have. So what we are dealing with, we have to now visualize what we can do. So number one, there's no deformity in the femur. We have to see how we can do a TBL resection and what we are going to fix. Based on these X-rays and the clinical picture and the gait, we showed a clear-cut, very stable knee. The planning was based on.
Let's ask some of the panel members if they have any opinion on how they would want to do this.
Yeah.
Rajesh, any opinion?
There is no arthritis there in the knee.
No.
Is that knee? I know the deformity and difficulty in walking, but is there a lot of pain in the knee?
Yeah, pain is there, but I don't think it's arthritic changes are there.
And he's 34. No, what is his age?
Yeah, he's 32, 30. Now he's 35, so it was done around 2.5 or 3 years back.
Did you consider doing any osteotomy? Because the deformity is on the tibia, it is an extra-articular deformity of the tibia without any arthritis in the knee.
Yes.
34-year-old. Certainly needs to be studied a little bit more, and if that can be done, that is my first option. to see if I can correct that tibial deformity by correcting.
In fact, we were shown to a couple of reserve surgeons, one in Maharashtra also, and they said that they will try and they will try to bring it straight away. But again, the dual picture, nobody can assure him that you will get it well and the movement will be good. So maybe he didn't opt, or maybe he went to one of my friends in Gorakhpur also, which where I sent him, because they are doing a lot of iligerov work.
The problem here is a combination complex of deformities. It's not only varus, it is flexion deformity as well.
And there's rotational deformity as well. Yeah,
it is rotational deformity as well. So it is certainly a very challenging and complex situation. Even for an osteotomy, it wouldn't have been easy or straightforward.
If the osteotomy surgeon says that this is not going to be corrected by doing osteotomy or etc., then you are left with doing a replacement. Is that what you're saying, Dr. Prasad?
Not exactly, because I am confident about replacement. That's why he sent him to other surgeons to explore all the other avenues if there's anyone. So before, definitely I did a knee replacement.
So we decide to do the knee replacement. A lot of this deformity will get easily corrected, but the problem is going to be a lot of soft tissue releases that you might have to do because there are multiple deformities here. So I think the femur, etc., is straightforward. The tibia, the extent of deformity, it still appears from this particular central X-ray that you can correct it intra-articularly. You're going to be left with a large defect on the medial side. You need a long stem and a constraint to be kept ready. Likely that you might need it, but that is how I would go.
Yeah.
What you did, Dr. Prasad.
Yeah, this is what, in fact, I was thinking on the same lines. Number one was I was trying to defer it, but once every other surgeon said that is not possible because it was a rotational deformity and they could bring up the condyle. I talked to Dr. Agrawal, so he said I can try to bring up the condyle, but it will never come into the proper alignment. So they will, how to do a rotational osteotomy and open wedge osteotomy, something like that, they will try telling me. So I don't understand much of the iligerov work now. So anyway, the problem was tibia. So my aim was to prepare tibia first, and then we can always match the femur accordingly. The releases were very important, as it has got a fixed rotation deformity, as well as a loss on the even when you open it up, you see the X-rays. The whole upper tibia is in torsion. It is not in alignment with the tibial tuberosity and the foot. So releasing contracture and scars and depth, how much depth we can go, that was again. And still we have to have a good stem. So if we are using a stem just showed with the line, it will have to be lateralized a lot. So these are the issues which were in the mind. And sleeve was definitely a good fixation. Only stem may not help, that I was very clear. And constraints, whether we want a CCK, TC3 or a hinge. So I was prepared with both. In fact, I was keeping everything. But I was pretty sure in the tibia, I'll be using a sleeve because of the proximal tibia was very deformed. So I can use a sleeve and stem may forget about this number one surface, but at least metaphyseal fixation and distal fixation will be good. So that was my aim for tibia. When I released, we had to do extensive release on the medial side. In fact, there was a scar which was not, the skin was very, just a symbol. There was a big scar on the medial side. And ultimately, I tried pie crusting, but it didn't. The tibia was never coming back to the normal. Ultimately, I had to do a little more pie crusting, ultimately it gave way. I had also to do a good release, keeping close to the surface or the rim of the tibia on the lateral side and going posterior lateral till I can start pivoting or rotating the tibia medially. So these were the two releases, and ultimately I opted out because you see the whole surface was different. So I had to bring and try to do a sleeve with facing tibial tuberosity anteriorly, and once that I could only do once I have rotated or the tibia medially, and ultimately I had to resect a part of the fibula also, because the rim which was there on the lateral side was very thin, and the surface was sitting over the part of the fibula as well. But the fixation I was getting on the proximal tibia was good through the sleeve. So I could lift if I wanted to the surface of the tibia. And this is what I did. And ultimately, I opted for hinge because I had lost a lot of medial collateral ligament strength. So I could have gone for a TC3, but I was not comfortable in the young age. In both ways, I was going to burn my hand. So I was going to use a rotating platform, but I opted for a hinge then. And this is what I did. And this is a 2 years follow-up. Still is doing very well. But at least this surgery made his life very well. This I can show. Even if it lasts 15 years, his prime of life will be covered. So 35 to maybe 50. After 50, I may not be there, but some other surgeon will tackle if there's any problem. Even the shortening is correct. Still, there is a shortening of around more than 2 centimeters, 1 inch. But he doesn't want any correction because he's very comfortable. He's keeping all his foot down. The flexion definitely is lesser than what he had. But his quality of life is very, very good.
Yeah, Dr. Prasad, that's a wonderful outcome. If you see the preoperative video and the postoperative video, you can really see how the patient would be thanking you immensely. Obviously, the problems are going to be there with young age, the longevity of the implant, how long it lasts. But at least for the first 10, 15 years, you should easily be able to cover. So that's an excellent outcome. Yeah, Rajesh, you want to say something?
No, and I think, Prez, that you may not need to do at the end of 15 years or even longer.
I'm very happy. Excuse me. I did a... THR in 1993 in a young age of 19-year-old. I have just revised one of his hip. It's a pure cemented Charley because this water was available in 93. And I have revised one after 23 years and the other still I think is working. So I had told him that you last 15 years.
I mean, that's a wonderful outcome. I'm sure the patients thank you for the outcome that you have ultimately. So that's really great. Any comments from anybody? Indrajit? I think you're muted.
Yes, splendidly done. And I think this was the best outcome for the patient, the way he was walking. And what happens in the future, no one knows. It may be that it can last 20, even 25 years.
Let's see.
But at least his prime of life, he will be comfortable. Yes, that's the idea.
That's obviously the outcome. Wonderful. Great. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that case. And I think we have last and not the least, it's Dr. Milind Kulkarni from Miraj. Welcome, Milind. And you can share your screen now.
Is it there?
Yes.
Yeah, we can see you. Yeah, wonderful.
Yeah, I bring greetings from Miraj. Thank you, Hemant, and everybody for giving me this chance. This is a 30-year-old rheumatoid lady with both knees, very stiff. And we tried all the instability tests and everything. It was not moving at all. She had both hips also involved. And now she was bedridden for many years and last 1.5 years, just unable to walk. She was even difficult for her to walk even with her support. And we had to take a lot of care for this.
Yeah, so let's talk about a rheumatoid patient who needs probably 4 joints to be done, both hips and both knees. And let's see what is the sequence usually followed by our panelists. What's the sequence that you do? Indrada, what's the sequence that you follow?
Hips first.
Hips first, okay. So obviously, whichever is painful, one you will do first, maybe even both in one sitting. But provided patient is symptomatic in the hips, obviously try to do the hips first. The knees are ankylosed, as you said, Milind. Yeah. What is the range of motion?
Just about 30 degrees, 60 degrees of flexion on the right side and 30 degrees, right side 30 degrees and 60 degrees on the left side.
Right, right. So did you do the hips first or did you have worse syndrome?
Both hips were bad or one of the hip appeared good?
No. Yeah, the right is obviously worse. Left, if it is symptomatic, there are cystic changes within the head. And but not as bad as the right one, obviously.
MRI is even worse.
All right, okay. Yeah, so go on.
So the mainly the our patients with a stiff, painful knee, they do something. They do walk with the support. But when the hip is also involved, they are really disabled. They can't do their routine problems. And these cases, there are, of course, soft tissue problems. And previously, for 5-10 years, she was bombarded by steroids. So, and bedridden, rheumatoid. So she was severely osteoporotic. And the hip first, because doing your future knee. And physiotherapy, after doing hip first, the knee physiotherapy is also better. And here, there are soft tissue contractures. So the implant positioning, I had kept the image intensifier ready. And so physiotherapy, everything went smooth. So, of course, we all use a young girl. So all ceramic on ceramic. Did the right hip, both knees. Then she came for the knees. Now, there was a mild defect, as you can see there. But it went quite smooth. I had kept all the armamentarium ready with the... This is, I think, the right knee. And I did the right knee, then the left hip. The debate we discussed was whether to do bilateral single stage TKR. But she was not very good. Of course, usually these hemoglobins are 6-7 and they are not very good. And I was worried. Because I was worried whether how much will the right knee will take a long time. But it went very smooth. I didn't have to use any other suppositories. And then I did the left knee. So both hips and both knees. I know, Yamant, it was a knee session, but hip and knee association.
That's fine. I mean, we do face these situations.
No, hip and knee association. So.
Yeah, of course.
So yeah. Now she is fine for this yesterday's x-ray, 5 years now, because she is a local patient. I called her.
Yeah, wonderful. That's a great outcome with both knees, and she's mobile and back on her feet, getting back with her.
And about more than 90 degree flexion of both the knee joints.
And her right ankle is already arthrodesed, I think.
Yeah, right ankle, somebody has fused it. I don't know why he did it, but if you can see this, and he has fused in a very unsound. Now she's coming next month.
For your ankle to be done.
No, I don't.
Meaning you're running out of joints now.
No, actually we shifted for deformity correction.
This is wonderful. Overall, how much time did you take? Because I have done some of them, some of these rheumatoids, and it has taken me about 1.5-2 years to finish all 4 joints because they are not very good nutritionally. Resources, other things. And how long did you take here?
About 1.5 months to 2 months between each joint.
So still about 6-8 months. I did it longer and longer.
Yeah, no, of course, the nutrition is not only the problem, the finance was the problem.
Yeah.
And now once I did the hip and knee on the right side, they started demanding for the other joint because she was very happy.
Yeah, that's the price you pay for your success, but that's okay. That you can live with. Congratulations, wonderful outcome. I think the problem sometimes is that if these patients are bedridden,
yes,
for them to even after the joint replacement, some of these patients I have seen just cannot manage with their mobilization and they continue to remain in bed, although pain-free, but still continue to remain. So it depends on their overall nutrition and overall, obviously, willpower and, the kind of general health that I think is important as well in these patients.
Yes. Only thing that right side, should I have put a rod?
No, I think 5 years down the line, she's doing well. Don't think about these things. She's doing perfectly well.
Because it went smooth. Within half an hour, we could do release. We not met, of course, minimal cuts, etc.
No. She's doing fine. So don't think about what you could have done. You know, enemy of good is better. So don't worry about it.
Okay.
You've done very well. Congratulations.
Looks very good, Milan. Very good.
Very good. Well done. Yeah. You can stop sharing your screen. I think if there are any burning questions, we can take those. Milan, you can stop sharing your screen so we can see.
I'm trying to do that.
Yeah. Yeah, I think I don't know if there are any questions. Anybody can why Dr. can share if there is any question, because I don't no questions have been communicated to me. So I guess we are okay with questions. Let me see if there is anything. All right, Sharon was looking after the questions, but he had to leave, unfortunately. So that's okay. I mean, as I said, overall, I think we have had a good flavor of the kind of cases that we see in our practice. And I think the kind of challenges that we face, I think we had a quite good variety and good flavor. And I think it was my decision not to invite any foreign faculty here. No disrespect to any foreign faculty, but I thought that we see excellent variety of cases ourselves. And, you know, the hinge is not always the answer. We obviously have seen that through this webinar. Hinge has to be kept available, but that's always the last solution for most of these cases. So I think I would like to thank each and every faculty member and panelist here for sharing their experience. And I think I would imagine that those attending this webinar had quite a good experience, learning experience. And even if you picked up a few points here, that's, I think, I would say that the webinar has been successful. I think this was the fourth in the webinar series that we have had. The next one is going to be on 12th of December. That's going to be on tuberculosis of the hip, arthroplasty in tuberculosis of the hip. And that's going to be moderated by Dr. Suryanarayan from Chennai. He is back in action, and he will be moderating the next webinar. So any final comments from any of our panelists who are here?
Rajesh? Yes, great job, Hemant.
Very good. Congratulations. Rajesh, nice to see you after a long time.
Yes, same here. Same seeing all of you.
All of you.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, and have a good
night. Bye, Raj. Bye, Prasad.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rajesh. Thank you, Hemant.
Indrajit.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you,
everyone. Have a great time. Great weekend also.
Thank you. Same to you. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for this wonderful session. I would like to thank all the speakers and also the audience for joining in this number. Thank you, sir. Stay safe. Good night. Take care.
Good night. Thank you. Bye.